Howdy, folks. Welcome to another episode of the Scannell Agenda. My name is Stephen J.F. Scannell. Today's date is January 19th, 2017. And today's show, show number 53, is Saquatucket Harbor in Harwichport. Well, I grew up right across the street from what you know now as Brack's Landing. Brack's Landing used to be known then as the Bourne House. And there was a little brook running next to the Bourne House, and it went past our house, which was across the street there from Brack's. And it's just a beautiful little spot to grow up. And I really do appreciate growing up there. And I was noticing today in the paper that there's going to be some improvements done down there. And I think it's great that the town took the property. You know, Alpain's, used to be Alpain's, it was a little store. And also Downey's gas station. I'm going way back. Across the street from that used to be just a sand lot, and of course the where Thompson's Market used to be, that used to all be sand. So I had a lot of good places to play. But when I was growing up in 1966, so it would have been maybe 8 or 9, they started digging. Oh, it was 69, I think. I'm not sure exactly when it was. 67, 68, right around there. But they dug out the harbor. It was one of the last chances you had to mess around with the wetland. If you didn't do it by then, they wouldn't have let you do it later on, of course, with all the laws coming up with the wetlands. So I really appreciate growing up there. Cheryl Smith was the harbor master when I was a little kid. He was a really good mentor for me, Cheryl Smith. He was a reverend, and he lived over by Rock Harbor in Orleans. And he used to like to have the kids around, and you know, he was very welcoming to everybody and very good at his job. And then, of course, Tom Leach was a harbor master for many, many, many years. He did a great job, and he's now a little of this and that. He does marine painting, and he's a fountain of knowledge. When I was a kid, I had a little boat in there called the Potluck. It was a 16-foot flat-bottom skiff. And then we also had an MFG, a little fiberglass boat with a 55 on it. Now, that was not a really good sea boat, but I used to take it out in rough weather anyway. So that wasn't too swift, but here I am. Saquatucket Harbor was just a wonderful place to grow up. I think Dad had designed the fact that the town should have taken the two properties out by the point. There were two properties there, and Dad had it on the town meeting floor, and Dad lost. He would lose sometimes. He'd get a little angry, too, when he lost. These people have no vision, you know. He wouldn't do that out to everybody, but with me and him, he might do it, you know, because Dad was my biggest mentor. But there was a walkway designed, and it was stipulated, I guess. It went around the east side of Saquatucket, and that would have gone out to the point, which the town should have owned, that whole point out there. But they, for some reason, the town didn't have the vision that Dad had. So there's a nice picture of our harbor master there, John Rendon, who doesn't like the red tape. The article gets into the red tape. Of course, nobody does, but nice picture with the boats in the back. Boats from the Chatham Fishing Fleet. See, Harwich always used to be known as, I think, the closest mainland port that was reliable to George's Bank, because you'd come around, you'd head right for Monomoy Point, and then you'd head out to the east and head out to beyond George's Bank if you were an offshore lobsterman. And I think it was the closest port, or is the closest port, to Nantucket Harbor. And that's maybe why it's a nice little ferry ride away, with a nice little ferry if you want a small boat. I've been on that ferry. It was nice. It was a good boat ride. And I can remember helping the guy to get his ferry, writing some letters and that kind of thing. And I hope that's all worked out for him. And the house that I grew up in, it says that, you know, Freedom Cruise Lines, the ticket booth. In the old days, it used to be 706. So whenever I see 706, it brings back the memory of where I grew up. And it's not 706 now, but it's changed. That was just a great, great place. We used to get softshell clams in the bends where the creek or the river used to be after they dug out. I got some good softshell clams there. Got some eels out of there. I guess there might be a few oysters, but just a few. I'm not sure now. I know down at Red River Beach, there were some oysters getting a start down there, so it's nice to see them get a start. Of course, the problem is oftentimes if something is getting a start, well, then someone's going to go in and clean it out, you know. So that's why we need good fishery management, and we need the market quota system, or the sea farm system. Maybe you're better off calling it the sea farm system. So the improvements to the harbor, it says, I've been frustrated with this progress. Nothing is happening fast. That's too bad. I'm sure he's doing a good job, although I don't really know him at all. But I have made an attempt to move back to Harwich. So we'll see how that goes. And I just joined the Catholic Church. I signed up with the Holy Trinity Parish, where I went to school. But anyway, yeah, I used to sell candy bars all over the place for the church. You know, they'd send us kids out. We'd all have to raise money. And I was a night watchman there at Saquatucket once. I don't think I did a good job because I was too tired. I was doing two jobs at once, and it was too much for me. I was working on Priscilla Skank's boat, the Capri. It was either the Capri was the first boat, maybe. And Captain Walter, he knew I was dog tired, and he said, oh, go ahead, bring the boat in. Now, normally, I could walk the boat right in. I was so dead on my feet. I said, Walter, can you do this? And he did, and he said, you're not allowed to do this. You got to come to work in reasonable shape. But I was working two full-time jobs at that point, one as a night watchman and one as the first mate on a yacht. And I had worked on a few boats. Of course, my boat, the Potluck, was not a real going venture. I was a kid, you know. I don't think I did the best I could because I was smoking grass. And I thought that was pretty neat. And, of course, you know my history. October 26th, 1975, I had a vehicular homicide right down the street from Saquatucket Harbor, Snow Inn Road there, and Route 28. Horrible crash. You don't have to call it an accident, because if you're negligent and you're smoking grass, it may not be a good idea to call that an accident. Although it was an accident, it was negligence, severe negligence. So anyway, back to Saquatucket here. They want to replace the harbor's badly deteriorated docks, electrical, water systems. You know, they want to upgrade it, and they want to go with the Americans with Disabilities Act. That's excellent. And they want to do some work for the ferries. That's good. Let's see, what else have we here on the list? That's good. So they know what they're doing. They're going to rework things. The money's incredible, but, you know, it's got a cash flow. It's kind of like, should we build a parking garage or not? Well, things like this, things like a parking garage, it has a reasonable cash flow to pay for, you know, what have you down the road, whatever you're doing, what investments are you doing, you know. So, and it's a big draw with the tourism, too. And the Yankee has been there ever since I've been a little kid. Go fishing on the Yankee. Yeah, so when the Chatham bar gets tough going, these guys from Chatham are always welcome at Saquatucket. I remember one regret I have. I kidded around with one of the Chatham fishermen about that once, and I felt so bad. I never should have done that. Because, you know, if your harbor gets frozen in or shoaled in, you want to be able to go to the next port and still keep going. But Chatham used to be pretty rough on Harwich people, too. There was an old rivalry there, which we don't need to get into. It's a Cape Cod thing. I think Nantucket had rivalries between, let's say, Matticat and town, fishing town, a fishing Matticat. And I was told all about that, and I said, really? You got to be kidding me. No, that's the way it was, and it was kind of like the Maine lobstermen and all the foolishness about the territories and all that. See, my system replaces a lot of that foolishness. It really does. Eliminates that foolishness. I'd like to emphasize how, I'm quoting here, I'd like to emphasize how important this harbor is economically to the town, said Selectman Peter Hughes. And that sure is true. Because if you're a town like Harwich, especially unlike Chatham, you don't have lots of waterfront as a huge luxury. You know, Chatham has a lot of waterfront. Barnstable has a lot of waterfront. You look around the Cape, Harwich wasn't blessed with lots of waterfront. We used to have piers that went way out, and I'd like to see those come back in. And I mentioned the other day on a different show how I would like to turn Monomoy Point area into more of an industrialized area for the coming of the Georges Bank mega mill and offshore wind development, that kind of thing. And it would have a raised track monorail system right from Monomoy Point right there. So most of the wild area would just remain wild. I think that Chatham should get its ground back. Furthermore, I think Chatham should get its territory back away from the federal government, National Seashore. I don't think it's really a good thing for Chatham. I think Chatham should ask for it back. Hasn't worked out for them. They've really been heartbroken by these advances by the federal government, Parks Department, whatever. National Seashore. My first trip offshore on a lobster boat, the Doris B, this nice guy, Jack Crossman, I was a little kid hanging around all the time, helping the fishermen carrying this or doing this and that. And so I begged everybody, of course, can I go out? And Jack said yes. Of course, he got my parents' permission. I think I got seasick as a dog. But that was one of the five boats I was on for offshore lobstering. And at one point, I know, I was told that Harwich had the biggest lobster landings of any port on the East Coast. So that was one of my jobs as a young man, going offshore on a lobster boat, which was the hardest work I have ever done in my whole life. And I've done that, so I don't think I could do it again on, you know, on the same level. I could go out and make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich or something. But I'm not in top shape. Although I'll say I did all right at the last job I was on physically. I don't know how I did it, but I did okay. Now, up the Well, anyway, let me get back to the layout of Saquatucket Harbor. There's two little brooks that come down. Now, to the east, you've got Andrews River, and that the Indians called Poon Pit by Gorm Road. And that went up into the headwaters was Buck's Pond, I believe, in the old days. So it must have been a massive, massive herring run in the old days. Now, we can bring that run back. And yeah, it wouldn't be all that hard to do, actually. And we used to go skating on Blackie's Pond, although that has been dried out because the thing now, the natural thing to do, what they're doing is, allowing Mother Nature to operate more or less without all the typical Cape Cod water controls that we had. I'm not so sure I'm with that 100%. I'm not sure I'm with the cranberry bogs becoming like an outdated relic of history and then let them get taken over by, you know, pine trees and such. I'm not sure I really like that. So Cold Brook is what it's called now to the west, and that goes up by Brax, and it goes up by my old house there at 706, what used to be 706 Main Street, where the ticket office is now. Now that, I was told, that used to be called Carding Mill Machine Brook. And the herring went up there, and when I was a kid, we could actually get quite a few herring there when I was a real little kid. That was one of our runs, our own run, right by the garden. And we'd put the herring under the corn. We'd get the roe out all the time. We'd get the roe out. We would not like to take any herring without getting the roe. Little Luwapena told me how they used to get all the ice from the bogs there too. And they'd use that for the fish in the spring. And Louis had a lot of secrets to tell me. One of them was they would lay out a grid using the black ashes, and then they'd just come along and score it, and it would break up into beautiful blocks for them. And of course, the winters were colder back then, so they could get quite a few, you know, quite a lot of ice, and they'd put it right close by in these ice houses that they all had. And of course, they didn't have water quality testing. They'd just go ahead and, you know, and use the ice from the bogs. So when Saquatucket Harbor was just a marsh, I enjoyed it. We all enjoyed it as kids. There were a couple land islands in the marsh, and we'd go out there and have a little fort in there. I was so little. And, you know, we'd come home all covered with mud stuff quite often. Born to the sea, someone used to say. That's growing up there. A kid is so lucky if you get born into it right there. Because if you're a curious kid, you get born into these areas, you've got an advantage somehow. I miss Louie. I just saw his grave over there at Island Pond in Harwich, where my brother Dave is buried and my sister Eileen. So hope I don't have to go there anytime soon. But I am in a bit of a pickle with my little problems of getting into the government and being an activist, so I'll let it go at that. I try to be reasonable, so this refers to the pond story on Nantucket. So, you know, try to let it go at that. I try to be reasonable. Sometimes I'm a little intense, but I'm 59, so I must be slowing down a little bit, I would think. Connie Holmes used to run the Caper. He was a great mentor for me. Ray Altavella used to run the Peg Arena, and he was a good, not so much a mentor, but just a great friend. And a mentor too, I guess. He's a good chum. Went out on a few little scallop boats there, a couple scallop boats. what a bonanza those years were. Some of those years, I remember I just saw in the paper a nice picture of some nice scallops. Well, we had such scallops when I was a kid that we could shovel them. We had a little debate about shoveling them into the culling box or not. And because, you know, there was a little bit of this and that, but it was mostly just pure, big scallops that would come up in the toe that you'd have sometimes. And that was just phenomenal, sea scalloping. And now the price has gone way up, I guess, up around $15 to the fisherman. And it used to be like $2, $2.50, $2.75, $3.50, somewhere around in there back in the old days. That was considered pretty good. You could do all right. But with the market quota system, as I mentioned on Facebook somewhere, with a percentage taken from the catch and then put back into the resource, into next year's catch, like a farm, like the sea farm, let's say. Say if you took 25% of the sea scallops coming in, 25% of the board price, and then you put that towards, well, there are many things to build up a scallop fishery, bay scallops or sea scallops. Many things you can do to ensure that you're going to have huge years of mega tonnages coming in, which would drive the price down, of course. But that's what we want. See, we don't want to be fishing for hors d'oeuvres. We want the tonnage. Seafood will be landed in great tonnage. It's one of my talks with this system that I've got developed. So you can do things with sea scallops, such as reseed Cape Cod Bay, Massachusetts Bay. Now, there used to be a fishery there all around the rim, as it was called, in a certain strip. There used to be good scallops and dragon. And if you read, if you read the old books by Phil Schwind, or if you knew some of the old-timers as I did, like Rennie Botero, who wrote out the hurricane of 38. They thought he was gone. Quite a master mariner there. So I fished for these old-timers. I wanted to fish for the old-timers. Something instinctively said, you know, gravitate to these guys. And I tried fishing with some of the younger fishermen who were kind of cowboys that didn't know what they were doing, and it just wasn't the same. So 5 minutes left here. I used to go out in my little boat, the Potluck, and I'd have about, I don't know, 150 pots. I had Dave and I, my brother Dave and I, had lobster pots, and Eileen would come out with me too, lobstering, and that was fun. It was either me or Dave and I or Eileen and I going lobstering. We'd put the pots on the big jetty for Witchmere. And, you know, it was a learning experience, although, as Harry Hunt would say to me on more than one occasion, boy, it's a fool that learns by experience, and it's a wise man that learns through counsel, but boy, you just don't learn. He was trying to get me straight. He was a good friend, and I disappointed him. Oh, broke his heart. Anyway, so the marshes have to be sanded now, and I have here something I'm working on. It's a hot air blimp or balloon, and it's designed to build the Trump Scannell wall, I call it, down there on the border, my border zone project. And this Trump Scannell wall has, you know, it's about 40 feet high. It's got a photovoltaic roof, and then it's got a walkway, and then it's got a pipe for pod transit, you know, my systems for monorails. Well, this would just be a pod. And then it's got three working floors below that, and it's very cheap and lightweight. It's nothing like the Great Wall of China, let me assure you of that. It's very cheap and quick, the way I've got it designed. And the blimp, purpose of the blimp would be to help materials in, and it would have some areas for assembly, and the thing would go pretty quickly. You could start in the middle with two of these blimps, or you could start at the ends and work toward the middle. But the border zone project is, I think, a keeper. That's a good one. And with Trump coming in pretty soon, I hope to get his audience. And along those lines, let me just read to you. Luke 14, parable of the ambitious guest. And he put forth a parable to those which were bidden, when he marked how they chose the chief rooms, saying unto them, when thou art bidden by any man to a wedding, sit not down at the highest room, lest a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him. And he gave instructions about this. And, you know, the whys and wherefores of that. Now, I think I've been humbled quite a bit. And I think I've been increased by this discipline. And I think what I'd like to do is ask the public, maybe if I get a little higher standing so that I can actually work on these projects for the County of Barnstable and for the National Marine Fisheries Service. Now, I want to take all these projects, and basically, here's one on Phragmites. Here's a file on Phragmites. Well, it could be any number of things, but I've been working so hard on these projects. And I think I've taken my discipline that's been imposed on me. And, you know, if I've done well on these projects, and we're going to have to thank some of these people that put me in this position, if I've done well, then they can say, hey, if I didn't, you know, get in Steve's business, this all never would have happened. So what I want to do is get everything scanned. And I necessarily don't want to publish everything because there's some real doozies that don't belong out in the public, to be honest with you. I brainstorm with the pencil and paper. So it would have to be Disney World approved, you know, before anything went public. And then I have a military file, too, that can't go public. That would have to go towards other people that handle that kind of thing. Because if you're an idea man and you design some system for the military and it's a really good system, what if you made it public? Then the whole world would have it. I don't want that. This stuff is a gift to the world, but with Donald Trump coming in, it's got to be a gift to the United States of America first, because Donald can handle this kind of thing. Donald and I think alike. We think about assets first. And then we think about growing those assets. And my dad was a businessman, and I'm my father's son. All right, that's the Scannell Agenda. Thank you very much.